in this edition of Art Loft. No boundaries. Carlos Luna.
Mi origen es de un pueblo de campo en Cuba. Y bárbaro, cuando se refiere a Green Machine, se refiere a esa máquina del campo, a la vegetación, que ha estado legitimando un discurso propio.
Dark Chocolate Japan.
I primarily work in acrylic. I do some color pencil, mostly in acrylic. I probably draw more than I paint. With acrylic paints, sometimes I just use craft paint with names like Dark Chocolate Brown.
And
everything I print, I try to eat, of course, except for the bait. That just goes back to be used as bait again. But yes, a lot of people catch their own fish and they'll call me and say, oh, can you print this instead of having it mounted? So people will call me and I'll print the fish and then I'll actually fillet it for them most of the time and return it to them, you know, so they get to eat it and then they get a nice print of their fish.
It's all ahead on this edition of Art Loft.
Funding for Art Loft was made possible by...
In the Florida Keys in Key West, every night is a spectacular show. And every day is another masterpiece.
This project is sponsored in part by the Department of State, Division of Cultural Affairs, the Florida Council of Arts and Culture, and the State of Florida. With the support of the Miami-Dade County Department of Cultural Affairs and the Cultural Affairs Council, the Miami-Dade County Mayor, and the Board of County Commissioners.
Hi, I'm Kalyn James, and from the studios at WPBT2 in Miami, this is Art Loft. Hi, art lovers. This episode of Art Loft will be an international affair. These featured artists are heavily inspired by cultures outside of our borders. That said, I believe the perfect profile to start our journey is no boundaries. At Pérez Art Museum Miami, dignitaries, artists, and arts enthusiasts gather to see the works of 10 Aboriginal Australian painters. This is No Boundaries, Aboriginal Australian Contemporary Abstract Painting.
A painting is paint on a surface, but the way it's done, what traditions are brought to it, both technical and the spirituality inherent in it, these are the things that separate. But they also help people understand one another.
No Boundaries is an exhibition of 9 Aboriginal artists from remote northwestern Australia. It showcases a moment when these 9 men transformed the ancient traditions of their people into stunning abstract works designed to speak across cultures. Using bright acrylic paints or thickly impastoed ochre, these men created works that were designed to dazzle, designed to speak of places that you've probably never been, of ideas that you've probably never heard of. Each one is informed by the ancient concept of the dreaming.
Marong kaparayano yung kaparayano ngapar ko yano tingar ngapar ko jarpang marong ka marawag ko yung ngapar ko aljar pa jarong ngorong aljar ang pa jar kani jar ngangal yun bigti pare nyo kada wala jar pa kini.
The dreaming is an idea that orders all Aboriginal being. It encompasses the creation stories, but it also lives in the daily lives of people. And it's this concept as big as the world in which we live, and it structures everything from the huge down to the minute. And that's what we see in these paintings.
We're an institution that seeks to create constellations of meaning kind of across international landscapes. And Australia, while geographically very far from us, there's this relationship to thinking about not only Indigenous communities and not only about different modes of art making, but also thinking about exceptional art that's being produced across the world without any kind of regard to who's making it or why they're making it. And this exhibition is really exciting for us because we want to think very much about breaking down certain boundaries between secular and sacred, between contemporary and ancient. And while we're very much a modern and contemporary museum, the great thing about these paintings is it speaks to kind of both of these kinds of long histories, while these paintings, when you stand in front of them, feel resolutely of the now. So that kind of in-between space that's very profound is something that we're interested in bringing into this space for our many publics.
We started out as a colony of the British Empire, and our initial engagement with the Aboriginal people was difficult. It was their land. But over time, I think we've come to much better appreciate that, their connection with the land, and their artistic expression is such a wonderful way of that being demonstrated, and I think ever more so. And the exhibits here, where you have elders who are steeped in their own traditions but are now using these fantastically vibrant colours and looking at the world through their culture, but showing things in a different way. And that's something that any country would be proud of, and we're immensely proud of.
For Aboriginal people, country is constantly revealing the essence of the ancestors. If you see a sparkle in a waterhole, or you see a shimmer in the sandhills, that is the tangible visual expression of the ancestors in country. And that's what's so marvelous about these paintings, that when you see these paintings sparkle or shimmer, when you see these paintings with all the gravitas of country, what they're trying to do is transport you to country. What we've got here is a little bit of country, a little bit of Kiwakura, a little bit of Balgo, a little bit of the Central Desert, and it's here in Miami.
Painting wagan 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 mau yang maru wangul, maru wanya doga berting hari, cukur mengayu, jamu kapali, balu jamu.
Now these paintings, a lot of them bear a very strong relationship to the landscape, and while you can see that in a vertical plane, when they're horizontal, it transforms them. You feel like you're looking over a topographical map.
When we talk about this exhibition, we spend a lot of time talking about ancestral narratives and these arcane concepts. But the most important takeaway of this exhibition is these nine artists are contemporary artists. Their work is dealing with the same questions as their peers in New York or Berlin. These artists are trying to cross cultures. They are trying to address the most important question of today, which is, how do we occupy this planet together?
This exhibit is actively touring the U.S. For more info on No Boundaries at the Pérez Art Museum Miami, visit pam.org. Up next on Art Loft.
All I had gotten was one Kokeshi doll at a train station. And I don't know if it was some cosmic fate or coincidence. One of the very first things I experienced when I came back to Florida was a Kokeshi doll exhibit at the Murakami. So now it was as if life was mocking me. Look, all these Kokeshi dolls.
From the Patricia and Phillip Frost Art Museum at Florida International University, we view works by artist Carlos Luna. Luna's cultural inspirations began in Cuba, traveled to Mexico, and now settles in Miami. During the Green Machine exhibition, we gained insight from the artist himself. Take a look.
El nombre de la muestra es Green Machine. Yo no fui el creador de ese título, fue el creador, el doctor Bárbaro Martínez Ruiz. Mi origen es de un pueblo de campo en Cuba, y Bárbaro, cuando se refiere a Green Machine, se refiere a esa máquina del campo, a la vegetación, que ha estado legitimando un discurso propio sobre la situación del campo, sobre el origen del campo, mi origen del campo. La cerámica de Talavera es un proceso tremendamente particular que tiene denominación de origen. Es una cerámica que requiere disciplina, paciencia, porque se vuelve muy frustrante. Es muy bella, pero es muy delicada. Esta pieza en particular se llama Beauty. A mí me parece que cada plato de cerámica de Talavera en un porciento muy alto es bello. Y yo quería hacer que eso se magnificara, y por eso cada pieza independiente, cuando la pones junta, se vuelve una especie de vitral. Robo Ilusión es otra pieza donde yo pedí que se trajeran estudiantes de arte con oficio, con un poco de entrenamiento, para poder rellenar todo ese muro que está atrás de cada uno de los cuadros. Fue vital que ellos me ayudaran, porque de otra manera yo no hubiera terminado justo para poder inaugurar la exhibición. Y requiere mucho tiempo de cubrir. Lo que hice fue proyectar la imagen, trazarla. Ya yo había hecho la imagen en pequeño, en escala. La proyectamos y el equipo realmente trabajó increíblemente a tiempo, eficiente y con mucha calidad. El Gran Mambo es quizás el resumen más compacto o la declaración más compacta de mi trabajo hasta ese momento. Resumía un recorrido importante de mi vida y declaraba un futuro nuevo por hacer. La estructura básica del Gran Mambo es un ojo. Por eso dicen el centro, mírame siempre. Es un trabajo introspectivo donde yo comienzo a analizar desde mi salida de Cuba, mi recorrido por México y mi llegada a los Estados Unidos. Lo único que hago es hacer un trabajo introspectivo, mirarme hacia adentro y sacar y hablar de cuál ha sido mi experiencia en todo ese recorrido. Por eso hay como una especie de avión recorriendo todo el borde de la estructura que hace el ojo. Creo que esta exhibición es un compendio poderoso de dónde se ha estado moviendo mi trabajo en los últimos años y que el público local no había visto. Creo que es una oportunidad maravillosa el que esta institución crea para recibir mi trabajo y la oportunidad que me dan de mostrar la obra.
For more on Luna, visit carlosluna.com. And for current exhibits at the Frost Art Museum, FIU, visit thefrost.fiu.edu. Have your travels influenced your art? Well, share your creations and collection photos with us at Art Loft SFL. Safe travels. Up next on Art Loft.
Colored paper, then the black ink process, then I paint over the black ink onto the colored paper. Some of these are collaged, where I actually do the print like this on the white paper, paint the fish, tear it out, then apply it onto the other paper.
At the Sunrise Civic Center Theater and Art Gallery in Broward County, artist Carlos Aleman takes us on a tour of his interpretations of Japanese culture. From pop art to the feudal era, Aleman walks us through his vision of Japan.
When I got back from Japan in 2013, I started working with a craft paint called Dark Chocolate Brown. And it got me thinking, maybe perhaps there's something more profound, maybe there's a play on words, and I came up with an idea. I started thinking about dark chocolate. And so dark chocolate is the antioxidant-rich, nutritious form of the deliciousness that comes from the cocoa seed, as opposed to regular sugary milk chocolate. So you would say dark chocolate is the best version of something. So a dark chocolate Japan, for instance, is the best version of Japan. I primarily work in acrylic. I do some color pencil, mostly in acrylic. I've been drawing, I probably draw more than I paint. With acrylic paints, sometimes I just use craft paint with names like dark chocolate brown. Pink Harajuku is a decorigo. There is something known to many as Tokyo fashion. They wear very elaborate costumes. The decora, the Lolita, the goth, and it's made up of many, many accessories and clips in the hair, and very colorful. My favorite sometimes is just the Shironuri fashion, which is just painted white. And it's just, I find it very interesting. What essentially it is they want to preserve their childhood. They want to be childlike. which I think is a good thing. When I came back from Kyoto, I had a pocket full of Japanese coins, and I found out I could not convert those to US currency, and I was a little disappointed because I realized I could have bought more Japanese souvenirs. And all I had gotten was one Kokeshi doll at a train station. And I don't know if it was some cosmic fate or coincidence. One of the very first things I experienced when I came back to Florida was a Kokeshi doll exhibit at the Murakami. So now it was as if life was mocking me. Look, all these Kokeshi dolls. So I said, I need some Kokeshi dolls. And I thought, wait, what if I could make them? So I started with wooden parts, and then papier mache, and then I began using duct tape. So if you look at some of my Kokeshi dolls, you'll find different types of duct tape. You'll find Hello Kitty duct tape, and skulls, and all kinds of patterns and designs. My painting, A Kokeshi Story, is a combination of many things. It's as if I just threw everything I could think of together that I love about Japanese culture. Cosplay Defenders is similar to, it's like a page out of a Japanese comic book, which they call manga. It features a kaiju, which is a Japanese monster. The cosplayer defenders are defending the coastline against kaiju attack. They have a robot, and it's up to the viewer of the painting to decide what finally happens to them. I want to, hopefully what many artists have done before me is shift consciousness. And art now can be anything, and that's thanks to all we stand on the shoulders of giants. All the great artists came before, and they kept pushing the envelope. And now, you don't have to worry so much about what you create. Anything can be art. And so creating, although I'm not Japanese, creating Japanese art, who's to say I can't do that? I think that what happened to me would be something that would be beneficial to most people, and that is finding something that is the exact opposite of you and falling in love with it. And that's something we need more in this world. Instead of labeling, analyzing, critiquing things, fault finding, judging, what if we learn to see something that's foreign, alien, exotic, totally different, maybe even strange, and appreciate that.
Sugoi desu ne? I think it's awesome too. For more on Aleman, visit carlosaleman.wordpress.com. And for the schedule of events at the Sunrise Civic Center Theater and Art Gallery, visit sunrisefl.gov. Next week on Art Loft.
A really interactive tour because it's all choreographed to music and sound and lights. And of course, the docent is always dressed in costume, so it's a little extra treat. Not only do you get to see these incredible wardrobes displayed beautifully, but we also get to take you on the stage. So you really kind of get a backstage pass. You get to see all of it when you're on the tour.
And from the Florida Keys, the Japanese art-inspired prints of Kim Workman.
My name is Kim Workman. I do gyotaku fish rubbings, and that is a Japanese art that originated about 200 years ago, and it was a way for fishermen to record their catch. So they would catch the fish, put black ink on the fish, press white paper, and get an exact replica so they could take it back to the emperor and show him, oh, this is what I caught, and they would have actual fishing tournaments doing it that way. My late husband was a marine biologist, and he did it for scientific study in college, and I've always painted, and he said, you should do gyotaku, or fish rubbings. I had no idea what that was, but once he introduced me to it, I started to add a lot of color to the rubbings, which normally you don't. It's traditionally done black ink, white rice paper, and just from there, it's just grown. You know, I've been doing it for 17 years, I guess now. I'm pretty much self-taught, although I had never used watercolor. I liked it, and it just worked well for me. So basically, I just did whatever I thought I liked, the colors. This, the one back here, is was printed in Nova Scotia. It was a 7-pound lobster. So I traveled there and bought it from the fish market, so they steamed it, took it back and printed it, and then ate it for 3 days. It's like huge. Everything I print, I try to eat, of course, except for the bait. That just goes back to be used as bait again. But yes, a lot of people catch their own fish and they'll call me and say, oh, can you print this instead of having it mounted? So people will call me and I'll print the fish and then I'll actually fillet it for them most of the time and return it to them, you know, so they get to eat it and then they get a nice print of their fish. It starts off with the black ink, as you saw, and then I paint the background that it's going to be on. And this was white. If I have the paper already colored, then I will print the black ink onto the colored paper. So it's, most people think it's done in reverse, but it's not. So colored paper, then the black ink process, then I paint over the black ink onto the colored paper. Some of these are collaged, where I actually do the print like this on the white paper, paint the fish, tear it out, then apply it onto the other paper. The one you see up here is actually on metal. I had in my mind, I wanted the fish to be like swimming like a wave. So that's metal and it's mounted on wood. And then I take the paper, I adhere it with wheat paste to the prepared metal, then adhere the fish over the metal on top of that, and that's how I get that effect. And the eye is key. Once you paint the eye in, it just brings the whole thing to life. And whether you color the fish in or not, just that eye, you know, it does it. And then when you put a little frame on it, you have a beautiful little piece of art, you know. Octopus is really hard. I've done several octopus, but there's no way to get them flat, you know, the body, and there's a lot of tentacles in a, you know, I will do it again, but that's one of the more difficult ones to print, for me anyway. Somebody said my art looks like diving on acid.
Thanks so much for joining us this week. Let Art Loft inspire your creativity every day. Visit WPBT2.org/ArtLoft to watch past episodes. And don't forget to get social with us on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram at ArtLoftSFL. I'm Kalyn James, reminding you to stay creative. Bye. Mine had grown out and they were looking so luscious, and then one broke and then everything else just went to hell. Well, they're fake? Stop it. They look good. I thought they were real. Sorry. I'll have to start it over. My breath was in a weird place, but it's just because of the structure of the sentence. There's no pause. Y'all gotta give me some commas. I still messed up right there a little. I paused right after Aboriginal. It didn't flow, but if it didn't seem weird, I'll do it again if you want me to, though. I was doing so well. Well. Yes. Don't do that.
Welcome.
No, I was fine. It didn't break me. Sugoi desne. I think it's awesome. Awesome too. And park the car in the harbor. So you're not gonna trick me, right? A little sass to it. Should have been like. Should have been like this. It's Art Loft.
Funding for Art Loft was made possible by.
In the Florida Keys and Key West, every night is a spectacular show. And every day is another masterpiece.
This project is sponsored in part by the Department of State, Division of Cultural Affairs, the Florida Council of Arts and Culture, and the State of Florida. With the support of the Miami-Dade County Department of Cultural Affairs and the Cultural Affairs Council, the Miami-Dade County Mayor, and the Board of County Commissioners.